If you're wondering what this is a vertical bass flute. And this is the debut of me playing the vertical bass flute on Phoenix Rising. So tonight's program is called Borrowed and True because saxophonists are always stealing from the flute repertoire. So I thought that in honor of Adolf Sax's birthday is today, okay? So Adolf Sax would have been 205 years old today. So in honor of Adolf Sax, I am doing some pieces that were originally written for saxophone, and now I am playing on the vertical bass flute and also for the regular flute. So why is the saxophone a little bit like the flute? Well, Adolf Sax actually played the flute and clarinet. So his father was an instrument maker, and so he dabbled in making instruments. So Adolf Sax's first instruments that he made were actually flutes and clarinets. The saxophone, which was invented in 1840, okay, around 1840, basically it was described as a new system of wind instruments, and the saxophone is made of a metal body in the form of a parabolic cone, a mouthpiece with a single reed, a range of instruments in 8 sizes, and a series of keys derived from those of the flute and clarinet with 2 octave keys. The saxophone became popular and was added to the Paris Conservatory in 1858, and then it was suspended in 1871, and then Marcel Mule was the person who reinstated the saxophone at the Paris Conservatory in 1942. So in honor of Sax's birthday, I am presenting Stacy Garrop, which was written for Christopher Creviston. Christopher Creviston actually commissioned it, so I'm actually stealing it. It's actually based on the image of the phoenix. The phoenix, as you know, in ancient times was a bird that basically at the end of the life settled down in embers, and then within the embers, then new life sprang forth. As the phoenix takes her last breath, the embers explode into flames with energy reinstated, and then a newborn phoenix rises from the flames, and freely the young phoenix starts to fly, soaring gracefully into the sky and climbing in altitude ever higher, its wings gleaming in the sun. So the first movement, Dying in Embers, will be on the bass flute, and then the second movement, entitled Reborn in Flames, will be on the regular flute. I hope you enjoy Stacy Garrop.
Thank you.
Creviston.
We knew.
The Villa Lobos Fantasia was composed in, right there, 1948, okay? As I was saying, that the professor of saxophone at the Paris Conservatory was Marcel Meul. It was composed for Marcel Meul. It was in the key of F for soprano saxophone, and Meul declined to premiere it. So the first performance took place in 1951 in Rio de Janeiro with Waldemar Spielmann as the soloist, and it was conducted by Villa-Lobos. But Spielmann only had a tenor saxophone, so the transcription was written one step lower from F to E flat. And this is the flat, this is the E flat version that I think this group over here plays. They're all saxophone players. So tonight you're gonna hear the premiere of the flute transcription. The flute transcription was found by Fernando Pacifico Holman in 2009. He was doing PhD research in Brazil, and he saw that Villa-Lobos had intended to actually make a version for flute. And so Sebastião Viana, who was a flutist, conductor, and assistant to Villa-Lobos, he made the transcription, and he took the original that was from F, and then he placed it a step higher for flute in G. So here is the Arizona premiere of Fantasia by Villa-Lobos for flute and piano. Thank you.
Thank you.
in back of this microphone, so I'm moving the stand a little bit over for those at home. Hi. Most of the flutists in this room know that Martin wrote a ballade, and the Martin ballade dates from 1939. Interestingly enough, the second ballade, which was for saxophone, was also discovered and published after Martin's death. Martin's third wife, Maria, found the score in mid-2008. So Maria Martin supposes that the arrangement of this second ballade was made for flute by Martin in August of 1939, probably the same year that the original flute ballade was composed. So this is very interesting because there are some similarities, notably the idea of chromatic half steps, whole steps, tritones, some real chromatic idioms that just firmly plant this in the 20th century around 1939. It's haunting, it's chromatic, it's dissonant. The extended tonalities pair what's in the piano, and then it's yet separate from what's happening with the flute. On the other hand, he has one of the biggest, longest, largest climaxes that he goes from very soft and low in the flute range to the absolute high. And it takes measures and measures for this to occur. And it's actually a pretty interesting effect. Then he has a really nice dance section so that he'll interplay really fast triplets, and then there'll be a cadenza so that the flute can show off some things, and then it's back to the piano, and then he loves to just have a steady build up to the end, and then after 15 minutes you think, wow, 15 minutes of music. So I hope you enjoy the Frank Martin ballade. And I know, I probably look like, wait, you know, I'm a little bit mixed on this piece. I'm not exactly sure. And I think this is what happens when it's a premiere, because this is definitely a premiere in Arizona. I know of maybe a couple of people who in the flute world have performed this piece. So it's rather still new. And so we'll see how it goes. I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you.
the true part. Truly, the second half, these two pieces are for flute and saxophone, Paul Arna, and then the Elliott Bark. So Paul Arma, we know him as a student of Bela Bartok, who did a lot of transcriptions and basically during World War II tried to save a lot of the folk songs of different countries. So he put out, during the French Resistance, a call for people to submit folk songs from Spain, France, Hungary, Armenia, the Ukraine, Bulgaria, and interestingly enough, his birth name was Imre Weishaus, and he was captured by the Nazis, and he was given a false execution, but then let go by the Nazis, whereby he then moved to Paris, and he adopted the name Paul Arma. So this delightful duo, you can tell, has a lot of folk material in it. And I think he uses the flute and saxophone pretty well. So we hope you like these 9 little duets, Divertimento number 18.
Thank you. Thank you.
program. A big shout out for Hannah and Christopher Creviston, because this has been really fun. The interesting thing about the Elliott Bark Shout for Joy is that it was originally written for one of Dr. Creviston's ex-students, former students, I shouldn't say ex. Okay, so one of Dr. Creviston's former students who ended up marrying one of my former students. And so this combination is the fact that this piece was written for them. So it is somewhat ironic that we're playing it now, and we were the teachers of both of these folks that got married. So Shout for Joy was premiered in Carnegie Hall, and I think it was their Shout for Joy that they were getting married. So we hope you enjoy, and this is original flute, saxophone, and piano. So Shout for Joy.
Thank you.